Dr. Am, thank you so much. This felicitation was is another feather in our cap. You know, every time I go to a meet and I talk, everybody expects me to give a motivational talk. Thanks to this video that you uploaded onto YouTube, and now I'm afraid I won't be as wise in every talk that I give. So apologies if I'm not making too much sense, as much as I did in that speech. But it always is a derivative of what kind of questions that are asked to you, and it's always important for people who speak to know the mood and the profiling of the people that he's speaking with before he starts to make sense. So most of the times I generally like to speak less, and I'd like the questions to be fired at me so that I know what it is that you're expecting from this afternoon. Salakhadus was of course a labor of love, as was Iridi Sutra, both Tamil and in Hindi. It was, you know, whenever you try to break the lines, you try to surpass the boundaries that are usually set by the higher ups, the older people, the wiser men in your society, or in the field of profession that you're in, the resistance is going to be very, very tough, simply because there is this Aristotle-ish feeling of say, hey, you know, we've been there, we have done that, we know what we are saying, so listen to us, this will not work. That's the generation of achievers who have achieved what they have done several years ago. And that barrier is there for two reasons. One is because they think that you guys, like all of us who are trying to break the rules and come out, are immature, and we are like them, and we're not going to succeed. The second more important reason is you're actually making them obsolete. If your ideas were to come true, if what you were saying and if what they were saying is wrong and what you're saying is right, and you break through a different barrier, then they will all have to admit that they're obsolete. They will all have to admit that their thoughts are old. And that is a bigger resistance. And that is the kind of fights that I had to fight when I did this film. Because people would say, who's going to watch a boxing film? We've already seen so many boxing films. That too, a women's boxing film. And then, Maddie, you're going to be looking like an old man. You're saying you're going to be her father's age. You're saying that you're not fighting in the film. You're saying that the film is going to be made in Tamil and in Hindi. And so every possible reason for not making the film was given to me. They said, we can't put that much money into the film. Who's going to do the World Cup? But three people believed that, and I think the biggest victory is in that. Three people believed that the Indian audiences, the Tamil audiences, were far smarter than what we were crediting them with or what we were giving them in terms of fodder, in terms of entertainment, and that they will lap it up when we give it to them in this form. So have any of you all seen the film? Can I see those of you who have not seen the film? Just being nice to me. No? Okay, good. So yeah, so this was a film where you know, so many rules were being broken that they said the audiences will never accept it. They said the same thing about Tanu Ajmanu. I couldn't release the film for 9 months after making Tanu Ajmanu original, because they said there's no Sheila Ki Jawani or Munni Badnami, there was no six packs, this movie was sounding like it was a 1980s film. But only Anand Rai believed it. I believed, and Anand Rai, the director, believed, and Kangana believed that it's an extraordinary film where people will lap it up, because it is the love story of the, like I call it in Hindi, Mitti Ki Khushbu Wali, where people look at it from the Indian you know, heartlands. Until then, all the love stories were what Yashraj showed us, and everything, all the love stories are happening in the US, and like, we never had any love stories in India. So I was very against that. So, but it was a tough fight. You know, you put in your money, you put in all your wealth, and you put in your conviction, and before it can be validated, you have to go through this little channel where people are telling you, can't be done, won't be watched, not be enjoyed. And that's always going to happen to every new idea that you come up with in your life. It probably has already, trying to convince your parents or convince your brothers or convince your family members that this is what you really want to do. And this is going to be a battle that you're going to fight all your life. So I think you should just get your weapons ready and understand. I think understanding the fact that there will be resistance from the most important quarters is the first battle that you've won. Understand that there will be. And if everybody is against an idea, not, I'm not talking about if they're against the way you're drinking and falling over every night. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm saying not with your lifestyle problem. But if you have an idea that you really believe in and you see it's coming from your very soul, it's coming from deep within you, and people are resisting it for no apparent reason, then know that you have something very important in hand and pursue it. I came to a point in my life with this film where I wasn't able to find a producer. I don't recall if I said this in Coimbatore, but I'm going to tell you this very important moment. At 45, yeah, you know, you keep learning all the time. So I came to a point where I gave up. I was training for 11 months in the US, and another 8 months learned how to box in Los Angeles and Chicago. And I was staying at my friend's place, whose name is Paresh Gelani, who's like a brother to me. And we got along really well. This guy's, you know, almost my age, but he's retired. And he sold his last company for some $900 million. I think he's one of the four co-founders of AI in the US. And he is extremely successful, extremely wealthy, and knows the who's and who of the world. But I stayed with him, and I really had a good time to just brush up against all that he had learned as a businessman. But when my final contract in Bombay fell through, I decided that this was it. I'm not going to do this anymore, because I had no money left. I had to, you know, make money as a filmmaker. So I said, let's drop Salakadus and Hiridhi Sutra. Let's do all the mundane other scripts that are coming to me. And that afternoon, I was very moved. I remember calling Paresh, and it's in the middle of the night for him. And I said, Paresh, you know what? I lost, man. I can't do this. This is ridiculous. It's almost like I'm the only guy who believes in it. It's like I'm being a bull in a china shop. Nobody wants to listen to me. And they all believe that this film is a goner. So he said, hang on, Maddy, 1 second. He said, I've sold three of my companies and become bankrupt thrice in my life before I sold my last company for $900 million. $900 million is not an easy amount of money. He said, my victory is not in the fact that I sold my company for $900 million. It is about the fact that in the last two times that I did become bankrupt, I didn't give up. I learned about people. I learned about people who were close to me. I learned about people who were trying to let me down. I learned about people who were trying to keep me down. And I still fought all that. And it's a result of all these fights during my failure that I sold the third company for $900 million. The next time you have another challenge like this, Maddy, you won't even come till here. You will know that this is futile. You will give it up. You will not take risks in your life. And so if you give up the film right now, you will never come this far even the next time you start a project. So he said, what do you want? You need money? You'll get it. But make sure you see this film through. Even if it doesn't do well, even if it flops, I assure you that the experience that you get out of this failure will be your biggest tool for your next success. And he was right. I'm saying those kind of motivational incidences in your life is something that you have to grab onto with all your hands and know that that will make a difference. And every and you know what? All of y'all will probably be not as successful as each other. There'll be some of y'all who will be professionally more successful than the others, and there'll be yet others who will not take anything out of this particular speech and talk and say, hey, you know, I know what I'm doing. Both of it is correct. But not all success is measured with your professional success. Your personal successes as well. The way that you end up smelling the grass after you make the money is also a success. Any man who has 5 crores or 10 crores in Bombay is living as luxuriously as me. Reason being, he could be traveling in a golden Rolls Royce. I'll be still traveling in Innova, but we both have to travel in the same road and the traffic is the same. His sons will be going to the same school. My son will be going to the same school. Even if I have 5 crores, I'll be going to the same hospital and afford everything possible. Maybe he'll have a helicopter that he can fly to the hospital with, but that's about it. Maybe he flies in his private jet and I fly in a normal jet on a business class. But after a certain amount of money, it's not how much more you can make. Everything starts to matter in how much the world that you've created around you appreciates what you have done. So there's no point in having $500 million in your bank account and nobody who likes you and nobody to share that success with and you not knowing what to do. It's like giving a 75-year-old man suddenly saying, hey, you know, we sold a property, here's 2,000 crores. That man would probably, who's living peacefully, you would actually die of stress right now because he doesn't know what to do with that 2,000 crores. So that personal success is equally important as opposed to your professional success. In my opinion, the personal success, the way that you that your family lives around you, the way that they rally around you when you try to achieve your professional success, is far more important. And so do not compare yourself with what I would call temporary setbacks and temporary competitive skills as opposed to your colleagues, because that is not the be-all. In fact, I was a very bad student in school. In fact, I barely passed in college, and that is the truth of the matter. But everybody has a complaint against me from school and college because they keep saying, Salah, you're the only guy who always had fun, who always had masti, who everybody's parents said will never make anything, he'll become a badmash, he'll be out of a job and he'll not have a job in his hand. And today I'm really enjoying my life more than any of those guys simply because I believed in what I was doing.
So how does it feel when you have succeeded against all odds?
Vindication is a great feeling. You feel, but once you achieve a large amount of success, the first thing that I do when I have a success or a failure is enjoy that or regret that for that one day, and I quickly wash myself off that feeling for the next day. I come back to being a student. So a big success, is especially against all odds, can be a double-edged sword, because you can dwell on it for the rest of your 6 months and lose the race, or just acknowledge the fact that your convictions have been proved and move on to the next project.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Ram. Thank you, Jay.